So there used to be a kiosk selling a language learning service in the Newark airport. Every couple of minutes, an automated message would shout out, "Rosetta Stone, the fastest way to learn a language, guaranteed!" Now, I can't speak to how effective those discs are at teaching you a language, and we all know the thing they got their name from, a 2,000-year-old stone from ancient Egypt that helped us translate the lost writing system of hieroglyphics. But apart from that, most people don't actually know that much about this artifact. So today, we're going to talk about the original Rosetta Stone, what it helped us learn, and the modern controversy around this ancient artifact. Okay, so first, a little background. You're probably familiar with hieroglyphs. These are the symbols you've seen written on ancient Egyptian artifacts or in documentaries like The Mummy, you know, the documentary. Hieroglyphs are the original writing system of the ancient Egyptians. The name comes from a Greek word meaning sacred carvings. The first hieroglyphs appeared around 3000 BCE, or roughly 5000 years ago, and they stayed in use for roughly 3500 years. In Egypt's long history, versions of this script were used for everything from decorating temples to writing grocery lists. But by the 4th century CE, hieroglyphs were mostly used in a religious setting, which unfortunately set them up for their downfall. Egypt was conquered and made a part of the Roman Empire in 30 BCE, and while the Roman Empire was historically fairly tolerant of other faiths, in 3rd century BCE, Christianity became the official religion of the empire. This new Christian empire ordered the destruction of pagan temples and banned the use of hieroglyphs. The last known hieroglyphs were made in 394 CE. Soon thereafter, people lost the ability to read them entirely. Luckily for us, the desert preserves things remarkably well, so for centuries, people could see that ancient Egyptians had left behind this treasure trove of writing on ruins and papyruses. Papyri? Anyway, even though they found it all over the place, no one knew what any of it said. Scholars over the centuries tried to decipher the mysterious script. In the 9th century, an alchemist living in what is now Iraq may have successfully deciphered a few hieroglyphics. Later, a 17th century Jesuit priest claimed to have cracked the code, though this work was later discredited. The big problem all these translators ran into was that they had nothing to compare hieroglyphs to. No one even spoke the language of the ancient Egyptians anymore, and nobody had any two documents in different scripts that they even thought might say the same thing? What the world needed was a key to break the code. That chance came in 1799 with the discovery of the Rosetta Stone. In 1798, Napoleon invaded Egypt, which was then ruled by the Ottoman Empire. The story goes that a French officer named Bashar was dismantling a fort near modern-day Rashid in 1799 when one of his men came across a stone carved with hieroglyphs. Bashar knew they'd found something special. See, the bottom third of the Rosetta Stone is written entirely in Greek, and scholars at the time loved reading in Greek. Bashar and other researchers of the day figured that the other two languages carved into the stone might be copies of the same message that was written in Greek. If scholars could figure out how to pair hieroglyphs with the Greek words, they might be able to crack the code on this ancient writing system. News of the stone echoed throughout Europe. This was the best chance in centuries for scholars to learn what ancient Egypt had to say in its own words. By reading Greek, scholars knew that the stone was a decree issued by ancient Egyptian priests to celebrate the accomplishments of a young king called Ptolemy V. All they had to do was pair this message with the hieroglyphs, and voila! Some people claimed it would take just 2 weeks to crack the code. It did not take 2 weeks to crack the code. All in all, it took 20 years before any real progress was made. A lot of researchers had their fingers in the pie. Many studied texts from Arabic and medieval scholars who tried their hand at decoding hieroglyphics. In the end, two major discoveries are responsible for the Rosetta Stone's decoding. The first came in 1814 when a British polymath called Thomas Young made a crucial realization. Most scholars at the time assumed that hieroglyphs weren't phonetic. Instead, they thought each image represented a discrete word or idea, sort of like like Japanese kanji. The Rosetta Stone had these pockets of outlined hieroglyphs in the stone, which we now call cartouches. Young realized that these pill-shaped sections of the text corresponded with areas where the Greek text referred to King Ptolemy. This led him to argue that the symbols in the cartouches corresponded to the sounds in Ptolemy's name. That was strike one for the symbol-only theory of hieroglyphs. Then a French scholar named Jean-François Champollion took it even further. Champollion realized that there were simply too many hieroglyphs on the stone for each one to represent their own idea. So instead, he approached it as a phonetic language rather than a pictographic one. Champollion translated Greek words into Coptic, a dead language that was once used by Egyptians before they picked up Arabic. From there, he was able to sound out the hieroglyphs, pairing each image with its own sound. In a classic Archimedes move, Champollion reportedly jumped up and yelled, "I've got it!" when he made the discovery. He published his work on this in 1822. And while this was a major discovery, it wasn't 100% accurate. We now know that hieroglyphs are a mix of symbolic and phonetics, and this system was so complex that we still have trouble reading them. But this moment marked the first time in 1400 years that anyone at all could begin to read this ancient language. But before we get into what the stone says, here's a quick ad break.
Thanks to Geology for supporting this SciShow video. Geology is a 42-time award-winning skin, hair, and body care company recognized in Men's Health, Hypebeast, Birdie, Esquire, Ask Men, and Oprah Daily Grooming Awards. But it's not just winning awards in the media. Geology wins with real customers who have left over 10,000 five-star reviews. And here's the simple strategy that got them that recognition. Geology creates skincare and hair care routines customized just for you. By focusing on a handful of ingredients that have been trusted by dermatologists for decades, Geology is confident that their products will work for you. If you don't know where to start in your skincare routine, you can take 70% off your personalized 30-day skincare trial set, plus a free gift of your choosing and up to an additional 50% off add-ons when added to the trial using the QR code.
Okay, now that we've established how the Rosetta Stone was translated, let's talk about what the heck it even says. Because the very first question on anyone's mind was, why does this ancient Egyptian artifact have Greek writing on it? This is tied to the history of the stone. The Rosetta Stone originally was part of a stela, a kind of square column with a rounded top. It was made in 196 BCE as part of a decree to celebrate the accomplishments of Ptolemy V, who at the time the decree was written was a whole 13 years old. The reason why Greek is included in the Rosetta Stone is that it was the administrative language used in ancient Egypt during the Ptolemaic dynasty. Alexander the Great invaded Egypt in 332 BCE. After he died, one of his generals took over Egypt and became pharaoh. So Ptolemy V is the descendant of that Greek-speaking general. The priests of Memphis are basically trying to hype this young king in the eyes of the Egyptian public. The actual message of the decree celebrates Ptolemy's military victories and his decision to lower taxes. The decree also states that copies of this message are to be carved in stone in all temples across Egypt. And indeed, we found around 28 other stone copies of this message so far. To reach the most people, the decree is composed in Egypt's three languages. You've got sacred hieroglyphs to speak to the gods on top, and Greek, the administrative language, on the bottom. So what about this middle part? This is a language called Demotic. It also has a long history that we simply do not have time to get into, but basically this would have been the everyday language of Egyptians during the Ptolemaic period. You see, Egypt was around for so long that their spoken language outpaced the writing system by a lot. By the time Alexander the Great was invading Egypt, hieroglyphs didn't really match up with how people actually spoke in their day-to-day. Like, if you ever go and look at how Old English was written, hieroglyphs probably looked like that to Egyptians living in the Ptolemaic time. Priests still wrote in hieroglyphs because it was sacred, but everyone else needed a writing system for the everyday stuff, writing a contract or a list or what have you. That was Demotic. Unfortunately, Demotic went out of style too because translating it was a whole thing. So the priests who wrote this message on the stone probably spoke to each other in a language that corresponded to Demotic, wrote in Greek, and had that message translated into hieroglyphs. This decision to spread what essentially amounts to Ptolemy propaganda written 2,000 years ago now means that modern Egyptologists can read hieroglyphs for themselves. And translating these hieroglyphs was more than just a fun exercise. Unlocking the secret to what the ancient Egyptians were writing about way back then helped us learn a lot of basic info we'd been missing. Stuff that's as basic as how old Egypt really is. In 1824, Champollion translated hieroglyphics from the 3,000-year-old temple wall of Ramses II. Champollion compared this list to a papyrus called the Turin Canon, a document that listed kings and queens, including those not typically counted in the official line of succession. Scholars at the time thought that Egypt was founded somewhere in the ballpark of classical Greece or Rome, so 500 BCE-ish, but the temple and the papyrus combined revealed that Egypt's pharaohs stretched back way, way further, all the way to 3100 BCE. Since then, hieroglyphs have been a key component in helping us decode the ancient world of the Egyptians. Nearly 100 years after they'd found the Turin Canon, the archaeologist Howard Carter used hieroglyphs to identify that the newly discovered site he'd been working on was the tomb of King Tutankhamun. Hieroglyphs and hieratic script, which is just curvy hieroglyphs on papyrus, has taught us about Egypt's dynasties and collapses and kings and, well, everything. The Rosetta Stone isn't a source of much active research these days, but its gift of decoding ancient Egyptian life is still an important part of Egyptology today. People often think that archaeologists have worked out everything there is to know about ancient Egypt, but that's not true. This culture lasted so long and had so many dynasties that each new site is an opportunity to learn something new about these ancient people. Like, we don't know a lot about the time that Egypt was ruled by people from modern-day Sudan during Intermediate Period 3, and whatever we'll learn about that time will only be possible thanks to understanding hieroglyphs. But while there's not a ton of ongoing research on the Rosetta Stone, it's a pretty hot topic for a totally different reason. At least three invading armies are intimately tied to the history of the stone, and that kind of violence leaves an impact. Today, the Rosetta Stone is one of the most visited artifacts in the British Museum, but not everybody wants it there. The British Museum came to own the stone after a combined Ottoman-Anglo force defeated the French army in Egypt in 1801. Part of the treaty required France to give Britain all the antiquities they'd found during their invasion. And today, the British Museum seems to be a big fan of the philosophy of finders keepers, meaning that they have no plans to give it back. Various figures within Egyptian academic circles, as well as the people in Egypt, would very much like the Rosetta Stone to be returned to its homeland. However, opponents of returning the stone point out that Egypt has its own copies of the decree found at other sites. But obviously, none of these other copies of the decree are the iconic Rosetta Stone, so advocates for repatriation aren't going to give up anytime soon. The Rosetta Stone was the answer to a puzzle that had befuddled scholars for hundreds of years. It was the perfect tailor-made solution to an otherwise impossible translational mystery, so much so that the phrase Rosetta Stone is a synonym for any discovery that suddenly broadens our understanding of a bunch of things all at once. So now you know the history and legacy of this iconic, controversial, and remarkable piece of ancient history, and the source of one incredibly annoying marketing campaign in the Newark airport.